chapter 5, verse 17. Make sure you have your pen and paper ready. Make sure you're going to be participators by saying amen. If you need to say amen in the chat, please do that. Of course, we can't hear your voice, but we want you, whatever you morning, let's make it happen today for the glory of Jesus this morning, for the glory of God this morning. Let me tell you, you get up early in the morning and you get virtual with your business, with your company that send those paychecks every week or every other week or once a month. Well, you ought to get busy for the Lord this morning. He has given you health. He has given you life. He's given you strength. And so you ought to praise God this morning because he is worthy of all the praise. Father God, we present ourselves as a living sacrifice to you this morning. Father Lord, we know, God, that you have set us apart. You, Lord, are sanctifying us right now. Father Lord, we thank you, Father, because you are sovereign, you are supreme, you are Lord of Lords, King of Kings. And no matter what we're going through, Father, you're the ruler over our lives. Thank you, Lord, for the new creation that we have in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, because Father, without you, we can't do anything. So we're confessing right now our shortcomings, our sins. We're confessing, Father, our inadequacies. And Father, we come to you now because, Father, you are all sufficient. And so, Father, we thank you. We thank you for these who are gathered here today who are listening, Father. I ask you, Father, right now, as they have the word of God in front of them, that they, Lord, will be attentive to the Holy Spirit. Let, Lord, you will, Lord, speak to their heart. Lord, speak to their situation. I ask it in the magnificent name of Jesus. And then, Father, before I end this prayer, if there is anyone under the sound of my voice that's in this meeting right now who does not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I pray, Father, that in the midst of the preaching or even at the end of the preaching or even when everybody's turned their videos off, that, Father, you will save them before it's too late. Father, Lord, we thank you because, Lord, we know your word, the lost today. We ask it all in the name. We pray, amen. Amen. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, it reads, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. I just want to deal with that one specific verse today where it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things have passed away. Behold, new things have come. And I've just tagged this message for your hearing this morning, the new me 2.0. The new me 2.0. This pandemic is touching so many people, so many lives today, isn't it? We continue to see unrest, even as the stay-at-home restrictions are being lifted in some parts of the country. A lot of folks are still struggling to understand how this is going to play out. The question I have been hearing is when will we be able to get back to normal? Have you been hearing that question? When will we be able to go back to normal? Maybe you've been asking it yourself. And I think the real question is, when will we be able to get back to status quo? When will we be able to get back to status quo? Back to how things used to be. Back to when the murder rates were up in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. Back to when people were dying in traffic accidents at the rate of 10 traffic by each day in 2018, according to 2018. People's faith in God was hit and miss, depending on how they were feeling at the moment. Back to when people hardly spent time or even seeing their children because they were working long hours at the job. Matter of fact, a lot of people spent less than 4 hours a day when they were at the job working 10 to 12 hours a day. Back to status quo of when people spent more money on gas than they did on groceries. Back to when your spouse complained you never at home, but seeing now today you're always there when he or she needs you. Back to when you created, I'm just talking about status quo, going back to normal. Back to when you created your identity around your occupation. Then around, instead of around your creator's real purpose of who you are. Well, I don't know about you, but I don't want to go back to the way it was. I don't want to go back to normal. I don't want to go back to status quo. So I want you to understand that God wants you to walk in the new you 2.0. You see, if they are lifting stay at home restrictions, now's a good time to walk in your new normal with no restrictions. That is what God wants us to do. Look at what he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. He says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. Status quo, or the old normal, if you will, have passed away. We need to embrace the new. I know that some of us, even as I'm speaking right now, have lost friends and loved ones directly or indirectly as a result of the coronavirus. But by God's divine favor, he has allowed us to see this day coronavirus free and should spur us to take full advantage of his grace on our life to what? Walk in the new life he has given you. I'm talking about the new you 2.0. You see, the old normal has passed, is what Paul is saying here. The old you has passed. This text is speaking of old things as referring to our old life. Our life before we were born again, or before regeneration, there was a spiritual change. And that's what regeneration means, is a spiritual change performed in those who have professed the Lord Jesus in their life, by which we become the possessor of new life. You see, in Christ, we are a fresh creation. If that's what the word means really in the Greek, when we look at new, it's a fresh creation from the Holy Spirit himself. And what is the creation from? It's a creation from a state of death to spiritual life. I'm about the new you 2.0, okay? You see, you are a new creature. The Bible is saying, if you're in Christ, you are a new creation. You know, you are a creation as to form and quality. You are, watch this, and somebody need to accept this today. You are unprecedented after Christ. You see, people knew you. They knew where you hung out before you got saved. But after you got saved, you became uncommon. You became unprecedented. You see, you became unheard of. I never heard that version of Quincy before, because I am a new creature. But sometimes we go back to the old ways, don't we? And when we go back to the old ways, we become common. We become heard of. Oh, yeah, that's how he acts, because that's how he always has acted. You see, because there's nothing new about him. But when Christ takes hold of your life, when Christ, when he tells the church at Colossae, becomes your life, he is your life, then you are unheard of. You are unprecedented. Oh, thank God for that. Because we need to understand that you are, watch this, you're not reformed, but you're transformed. You're not reformed, but you're transformed. You are all new. You are a fresh creation. You didn't turn over. Oh, no, you're not reformed and you're not rehabilitated, but you're all new. Don't let people tell you, oh, you just turned over a new leaf. No, you need to stop him and say, no, baby, I've been recreated. I've been recreated. I'm all new. This is the new me, the new version, the new me 2.0, because I've been transformed. You see, your old self was crucified with Jesus. We need to understand that our old self was crucified with Jesus. That's what Romans 6:6 talk about. You see, so we are new. We who are in Christ have laid aside the old self and put on the new self. I wonder how many people have laid aside the old life and put on the new. How many of you have done that? You see, God doesn't care what you were before, whether you were moral or immoral, a liar, a thief, a person who did good works. God doesn't care about all that. No, you are now newly made, and God owns his workmanship. He owns us, that is, as his workmanship, and which he can now look on and pronounce very good. Just as he created the world, he said everything that he made was good. So when he created you, he says, you're very good. Amen? Your new you 2.0 looks good on you, church. It looks good on you. God says, I have quarantined your chaotic disorder, which is your old life, and now have capacity of knowing me and who I am to you as a new creature. You see, it doesn't mean that you would never sin, because we are still incorruptible or fleshly bodies, and we will sin. But when you are a new creature, church, when you are a new creation, instead of willfully and continually chasing after sin, we have the power to resist the pull of sin. And now the difference, beloved, is that sin chases after us. We no longer chase sin, but sin chases us. That is the new you 2.0. That is the new you 2.0. So the old things, the ancient things, that's what old means, ancient things, have what? Passed away. The former things, the old fashioned or worn out of what was long ago, have passed away. That's what this scripture is yelling at us. It has passed away. That old fashioned, that old worn out of what you used to do long time ago is passed away. It's passed away. And behold, he says, new things have come. You know, I was recently looking at my closet to find something up to date to wear at meetings. And I noticed that all I had were some old worn out clothes. That's all I had was some old worn out clothes. Because the shopping stores have been closed. We haven't been able to go and get the clothes that we want. Now, I know some of y'all do Amazon and all that other stuff. That, you know, I'm there, but I haven't got So I'm still wearing some old worn out clothes. Some people would say those clothes have gone out of style. Those clothes have gone out of style. We need to upgrade our wardrobe. We need to upgrade our wardrobe. So we have people who need to change their wardrobe and throw away those old clothes because they are no longer new. They are out of style. They are worn out. And this is what the old life is under Adam. It's sinful. You were chasing sin. You're worn out. You need to throw it away because it's not going to do you any good. And how many are walking right now in the YouVersion 1.0? That's the old self. That's the old way. That's the ancient way. You got an old way of thinking. You got an old way of walking. You got an old way of doing things. Because why? You have not embraced the new you 2.0. Let me encourage you to allow the creator of heaven and earth to give you your new you 2.0. So you can influence the world with an upbeat message, not an old message from an old version of you. And a lot of people right now are missing their blessings because they are walking in the old version of themselves. You see, because let me tell you, when you're walking in the old version of yourself, you're walking really in spiritual death. There is no life in what you're doing. Anything that you're pursuing, it's in vain. It has nothing to do with world values. God is saying, I have something better for you. I have something better for you. So I want to give you really two things to really walk away as you embrace the new me 2.0. Can I give you two things? Okay. The first thing I want you to embrace is you need to loosen your restriction of the intake of the word of God. You need to loosen your restriction of the intake of the word of God. Now, right now, there are a lot of people right now who are walking, and you have tightened your restrictions. You have tightened your restrictions, not only physically, because you don't want to get the coronavirus. Of course, you do that, you're following man's laws telling you to self-quarantine. You know how we are. We're self-quarantined right now. We have to quarantine ourselves. We have to make sure that we do not pass on the disease to someone else. But God is saying that you don't need to self-quarantine yourself when it comes to the word of God. You need to actually loosen your restriction of the intake of the word of God. And let me tell you, in the new normal, church, you need to, in the new normal, be a high dose taker of God's word to cure the disease of old living lifestyles. Be a high dose taker of God's word to cure the disease of old living lifestyles. And let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, that if you are what Paul says, if you are in Christ, then you should run away from those old living lifestyles. But the only way you can do that is that you need to loosen your restrictions. Because let me tell you, Satan, he's looking to trip you up in life. He's looking to entrap you in life. And the only way you can fight someone that you can't see is by the word of God. It's by the word of God. And I don't know how you can get through a day without reading the word of God, because you need to understand that God's word has the power. It has the power to reach the innermost part of us and judge our thoughts. His word is powerful. And the scripture says it's powerful than any what? Two-edged sword. Because what? It pierces to the depths of our soul. And you know what? The soul and the spirit can be involved in what pleases or displeases God. So God, he searches your mind, he searches your heart, and he tells you, Quincy, look, I'm not pleased with that. You need to get away from that old lifestyle, because that's not part of the new me 2.0 version. I've created a better version. It's better than what you ever thought of before, because guess what? Behind the new version, God, he is on the inside, and he is giving me life. He's giving me power so that I can attain the riches of blessings that he has for me. But you know what? I need to be a high dose taker of God's word to cure the disease of old living lifestyles. How many of you right now are struggling with your old lifestyles? If you're saying, yes, I'm struggling with my old lifestyles, then you need to be a high dose taker of God's word. You need to be ingesting God's word. No, not physically tearing the papers out and chewing. By saying the scripture out loud, by coming and hearing the preacher preach from the word of God, by looking at other people's lives who are what? Modeling the word of God. You need a high dose of God's word in your life. That's the only way you can do it. That's the only way reason. That's the only way you can walk in the lifestyle that God has called you into in the new me 2.0 version. But then secondly, my brothers and sisters, before I leave that thought, I want you to understand something about the word of God. It gives you wisdom. It gives us wisdom that leads to salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. That's 2 Timothy 3:15. We need to understand that God's word gives us wisdom. It gives us wisdom when we need to know God's will in our life. We need to know God's will today more than any other day that we've ever lived in, because God, he is yelling at us today. He is yelling from heaven today, you need my word. The only way to get through this situation is my word. You need my word. But then, my brothers and sisters, I want to give you the second way here. The second idea here is to lose your old life so that your new life can begin. Lose your old life so that your new life can begin. Brothers and sisters, we need to understand that God has given us a new life. He has given us a new life. When you have professed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, God has transformed your life. He's transformed your life. You need to lose your old life so that your new life can begin. See, a lot of people think that, hey, once I accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, my responsibility is over with. No, that's not true. You have a responsibility. You see, God has already taken care of your sin debt. He has already taken care of where you will spend eternity. But now, brothers and sisters, you need to lose your old life so that your new life can begin. And how do you do that? You need to quarantine the old man to prevent reinfection. You need to quarantine the old man to prevent reinfection. And you can do that by embracing the struggle of prayer. By embracing the struggle of prayer. You need to understand that, because prayer, it can be hard work, can it? But that should not keep us from praying, even when it requires sacrifice in our life. You see, in your old self, in your version 1.0, you wouldn't even be chasing a relationship with God. You would not even be concerned about spiritual matters. But in the new me 2.0, you ought to struggle in prayer And a lot of people think that prayer is supposed to be so easy and it's supposed to come so naturally. Didn't I tell you that you're still living in this carnal body? You're still living in the flesh. Let me tell you, anything when it comes to pursuing a relationship with God is going to take some work on your behalf in experiencing new life, and especially with prayer. You have to struggle in prayer. Struggle, embrace it. Don't run away from it. And say, Lord, I don't feel like praying right now, but I'm going to pray anyhow. And you see, when you do that, my brothers and sisters, God, he listens and he hears that prayer. And let me tell you, the Holy Spirit, who's on the inside of you, he knows that you don't know what to say in your prayer, so he intercedes on your behalf. He intercedes when you're struggling. He intercedes when you're on your knees and you don't know what to say. You don't have to have a doctrine or a master's certificate in prayer. You just need to trust the master who you're praying to. And he's gonna make it all right. Notice, not only should you embrace the struggle of prayer, but brothers and sisters, let me tell you, you need to also embrace, watch this, the fellowship of God and other believers. You need to embrace the fellowship of God and other believers. And I don't understand, really. It's foreign to me how you say you have a relationship with God, but you don't even want to be around God's people. We got you all on muted. I know everybody would be saying amen right now, but I can't hear you right now. So someone needs to chat it right now. Amen. How many people who are born again, they do not embrace the fellowship of his people? They want to live on a spiritual island. They want to live on a quarantine island. They want to do what they want to do. They don't want to have any accountability, not only to you, but they don't even want to have accountability of God. Let me tell you, that's not a relationship. You're still operating in version 1.0. You're still operating under the sin curse of Adam, the first Adam. And I'm saying, come on over here, child. Come on over here. Come on to the other side, to the new version, because there's a new version of you. It's 2.0. And let me tell you, Jesus created that version of you. And all you need to do is walk on in it. And when you start walking in it, you're going to embrace the fellowship of God. You're going to embrace not only that, but the fellowship of his people. We need to embrace the fellowship of God. I said this in Bible study a few weeks ago. I said, you need to ask yourself, do you really have fellowship? Do you have true fellowship or fake fellowship? You see, fake fellowship is when you have people who don't believe in Jesus, and that's all you hang out with. But here is the mark of someone who has true fellowship. True fellowship is someone who can hang out with non-Christians, but then after hanging out with non-Christians, watch this. Non-Christians start to what? Get what? Saved. Why? Because they see, hey, I want that new version. I want that version. I want a better version of me, just like this person. And a lot of people right now are being influenced by the wrong people. And brothers and sisters, we need to have fellowship with one another. Because you know what? God the Father had fellowship with God the Son. And God the Son had Holy Spirit. And let me tell you that God the Father is having fellowship with God the Holy Spirit. And God the Son is... It is working in the Trinity that they're having fellowship with one another. God has created us to be fellowship beings. that we will fellowship with one another. So embrace the struggle of prayer, embrace the fellowship of God and other believers. And then finally, watch this. You need to embrace, or you need to enter his presence with worship. You need to enter his presence with worship. You know how you can quarantine the old man? Is get in the presence of God. Because when you get in the presence of God, you will not leave the same that you came in. You get in the presence of God. That's how you can quarantine the old man, is you can get in the presence of God. And let me tell you, when you get in the presence of God, you're just not going to stand there. No, you're going to worship him because he's worthy of all the glory and the honor. Matter of fact, God desires those people who what? He desired true worshipers. You see, those who would worship him in spirit and in truth. If we are to worship God in truth, not in error, we must seek to know him by learning about who God is, who he is. We worship God because only he is worthy of our devotion. He is worthy of not just any devotion, but our highest devotion. You see, God is worthy to receive, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 4, glory, honor, and power. Why? Because God created, watch this, all things. I told you, he created all things. And God created all things. And when we do the creation, my brothers and sisters, let me tell you, it's perfect. It's perfect. Well, you need to loosen your restriction of the intake of the word of God, and you need to lose your old life so that your new life can begin. And watch what Paul says in verse 18. He says, watch this. Now all these things are from God. I love that. Now, all these things, I don't want you to get it twisted. I want you to know where it came from. It came from God. He said, now all these things are from who? God, who reconciled us to himself. Oh my gosh, the death of Christ changed. That's the meaning of reconcile. Changed. Watch this. The position of all people to being saved. He changed our position. That's reconciliation. He changed our position. Aren't you glad that God changed your position? Because under the old position, under the old self, the version 1.0, you were on your way to hell. You were on your way to hell because you were not pursuing God. You were not pursuing the things of God. But notice, through Jesus Christ, he changed it all, didn't he? Through Jesus Christ's blood, his sacrificial death on the cross, he changed the whole world. Let me tell you, he brought some interference in the world. Right now, we got some interference right now. God said, oh, going on the way it is, like I'm not on the throne. I'm going to throw some interference. And the interference stopped the whole world, didn't it? That interference stopped the whole world because he's reminded us that, you know what? We need to embrace the struggle of prayer. We need to embrace the fellowship of God and other believers. And we need to enter his presence with worship. Now, if we've embraced that, now go tell somebody else, because you know what? You got a new message. Because you, why? Because you're walking in the new me 2.0. You're walking in the new version of you, because he has given you a fresh anointing to go and tell a dying world that Jesus lives. That Jesus lives today. He lives. I don't care what the world tells you, but my Savior lives today. My Savior lives today. He allows me to walk in the new me 2.0. Yes, that old Adamic nature tugs at me, but you know what? It's going to always be chasing me, and I'm never going to chase him again. I'm never going to chase him again because why? Because through Christ, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm not going to chase sin. I'm not going to allow people to take me off of my created pathway. Because why? I'm a new me, 2.0. Can you walk in your new version of you? Will you walk in your new version of you? Well, maybe there's one here today who said, you know what? The struggle is real, Pastor. And let me agree with you, the struggle is real. But you know what? The power of God is real too. The power is more struggle. The power is more than your struggle. I think what other people say, that the struggle is real. All you're doing is magnifying the struggle. Let me tell you, put a magnification on Jesus, and then you'll never say, hey, the struggle is real. What you're going to be saying is that God is real. He's real. He's real in my soul today. Because God has created a new version of me. Yeah, I may falter at times, but you know what? God is not going to allow me to struggle through life because that was under the old man. He has created the new me. So here it is. The old you, 1.0, didn't have anything to share, but the new you, 2.0, who in Christ, you have Jesus to share with others. Amen. If you are here today and you do not know Christ as Lord and Savior, we want to invite you to know him today because he is real. And we know that he has died on the cross for our sins. He was buried and rose again on the third day with all power of heaven and earth in his hand. And as the slide will tell you, the bad news is every person is a sinner. Amen. Every person is a sinner before a holy God and unable to save themselves. You see, the problem is the old version 1.0. That's the problem is the old version. Because the scripture says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But then next, I want you to understand, watch this, in the next slide we see is the penalty. The penalty, every person under the sentence of death and will be forever separated from God because of their sin. That's what the old Adamic nature brought, is sin into the world. And let me tell you, that's the old version 2.0. Therefore, just as though through one man, that is Adam, sin entered into the world. And so death spread to all men because all sin. You see, you can't get away from it. You can't get away from it. And God knew we couldn't get away from it. So he gave us the good news. Here is the good news. Through the substitutionary, sacrificial death of Christ, God has addressed the sin problem for us. Can't you see the new me 2.0 in process? Here it is. But God demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's the provision. That's the good news, my brothers and sisters. And here's the pardon even, that God offers a free pardon and eternal life to all who place faith alone in their Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation. Because the scripture says that if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. Why don't you walk in the new version, the new me 2.0? Father, we thank you for the pardon. We thank you for the forgiveness of sin. Now, God, we ask that we would now walk in the new version. Because, Lord, you have already said in your word, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things have passed away. Behold, new things come. Let us embrace, Father, the new things that you have for us, while we also glorify you in our bodies. That we would embrace one another, that we would pray for one another. We pray for our leaders. We pray for those who are overseeing this world today. And Lord, I ask that you give them wisdom. But Lord, we know that you're still on the throne. You're supreme. You're Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And this, Lord, we know that we have all sufficiency in your rulership. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Speak up when you're wrong. If I walk a little taller.